Hi, this is Raphael Mudge, the creator of Cobalt Strike. In this video, I'm going to demonstrate the TCP Beacon. Here we are in Kali Linux with a foothold on Workstation 1. I'm going to click on the headphones to open the Listeners tab and press Add. For payload, I'm going to select Windows Beacon TCP Bind TCP. This is the TCP Beacon listener. The TCP Beacon listener is a payload for peer-to-peer communication, very similar to the SMB beacon. The difference is this. The SMB beacon uses a named pipe for peer-to-peer communication, and the TCP beacon uses a TCP socket. That's it. That's the difference. So let's give it a name. We'll do local beacon TCP. Because this is a bind payload, the host field has no effect. The port here configures the port of the bind TCP stager only. The beacon TCP payload stage does bind to a port as well, but that is specified in your malleable C2 profile. It is the TCP underscore port option. Let's press save, and here we go. We now have a pivot listener, a TCP beacon listener. Now let's go ahead and interact with the session and take a look at what it's like to use the TCP beacon. Let's just do a whoami/groups to see what context we're in. And we can see that we are an administrator, but we're running in a medium integrity context. So let's go ahead and elevate, going to access elevate. And we'll use our TCP beacon listener, and we'll use the UAC token duplication exploit, which is a very handy option because it works. Let's go ahead and press launch. And if all goes well, we will end up with a new session linked through our existing beacon. And here we are. Let's click on the pivot graph. We now have a Jim Stevens running in a high integrity context connected to our foothold via a TCP socket. Let's go ahead and interact with that new beacon. One of the downsides of UAC token duplication is that when we elevate, we end up in a session that can't do much. It is a privileged session, but it can't touch processes in another desktop session. Okay. So if I try to run Mimikatz, for example, we just get an error. So how else can we use the TCP beacon? Well, we can use it to get out of this predicament. That's what I'm going to show you. For example, let's go ahead and do a psexec powershell to localhost, and we'll target the TCP beacon. This should work because our token is elevated. And here we go. We now have a system level beacon session linked through this other session. And in this new session, we can do our privileged things. So that's an example of using the lateral movement commands targeting a TCP beacon. Now myself, I'm not a big fan of using a bind TCP stager for network staging. The bind TCP stager is essentially an unauthenticated backdoor until it's used. Now remember, in Cobalt Strike, stagers do not do any verification. All the security features are built into the payload stage itself. So if you want to avoid the use of a bind stager in lateral movement, you can use a stageless payload. And I'd like to demonstrate what that looks like right now. So let's go ahead and get rid of these tabs. And we're going to work from this session here, from our foothold. Let's go to attacks, packages, Windows executable S, and let's go ahead and export a TCP beacon payload stage. And the output is going to be a service executable that is 64-bit. Okay, so that's all that. Press generate. We'll call this beaconsvc.exe. All right, great. Now, the system we're going to target will be the mail server. And you can see right now we don't have privileges to it. So let's go ahead and just make a token for the administrator account. And let's verify that we can hit the mail server. We can. Great. Now let's go ahead and just do a little bit of old-fashioned lateral movement by hand. So we're just going to CD over to the mail server, C Windows temp, and we're going to upload beaconsvc.exe. And we're going to run the sc command to create a service to run our beacon service. So we'll just do sc on the mail server, create beacon service, C Windows temp, beaconsvc.exe. And let's start that service. And great. Now, similar to the SMB beacon, when you start a TCP beacon on a remote host, it's waiting for a connection. You have to assume control of it. And the way we do that with the TCP beacon is we use the connect command. So let's just go ahead and do connect over to mail. And there we go. We now have a new session controlling the mail server. All right. Now, if we want to disconnect from the mail server, we can with the unlink command. So unlink does both the TCP and SMB beacons. And there we go. We're now disconnected from the mail server. If we want to, we can reassume control of it with the connect command. And I'm going to demonstrate that by showing you one more thing. It's kind of interesting. So let me create a new session by logging into a Unix target in this environment as the user on 10.10.10.21. And we now have, or will have, an SSH session. And there we are. Now let me interact with it. And SSH sessions happen to have the same connect command. So I can do connect over to mail and assume control of the mail server via our SSH session. And if we come over here, let's just go ahead and unlink the, unlink this mesh here. Let's come back to our SSH session and let's connect to workstation one. Oops, let's put in the fully qualified name. Let's see if that makes a difference. And yes, there we go. Here, I've demonstrated reassuming control of a beacon mesh with an SSH session. Yes, SSH sessions and Cobalt Strike can control TCP beacons. And this is really cool from a tradecraft perspective, because if you happen to have a Unix server that you can reach from the outside and it can reach targets on the inside, you now have a connect-in backdoor that can assume control of a beacon mesh in that network. So you don't always have to beacon out to control your targets. So that's a demonstration of the TCP beacon in Cobalt Strike 3.13. I hope you've enjoyed this demonstration. Good luck and happy hacking.